My name is Lydia Mungare, and welcome to another episode of the Freelancer's Mic, where we have conversations with creatives. It's all about you getting the mic and sharing your experiences. So on today's podcast, we have Bea of Bea Virtual Assistant Services. She is a podcast manager helping podcast hosts with their podcasts from pre-production to production and post-production. She's here to share with us all she has, all she has done, the experience she has all about virtual assisting and podcast management. So, Bea, how are you doing today?
Hey, Lydia, thank you for having me. I'm doing well.
I'm excited to have you on the show. So could you briefly tell us about yourself, a brief background about Bea?
All right. Oh, my name is Beatrice Mugure, but I prefer being called Bea for some good reasons. I don't know which. I am a podcast manager cum virtual assistant, and also I'm into 8 to 5. I am the customer relationships manager at Octagon Data Systems. I am a mother of 2, and I am so happy to be in the podcasting world. It's therapeutic and it's beautiful just to get people information that they can easily consume when going about their activities.
Wow, that's awesome. You're doing a good job. Can you share your journey and how you got started as a podcast manager?
My journey circles back to 2019. So I was trying to get jobs here, there, and someone posted in one of the Facebook groups, I think the Awesome Transcribers Kenya, they needed someone to do show notes for them. To be honest, I didn't know what show notes are, but I decided if it can be done, then I'll be the person to do it. So I got in touch with them. I think the lady was called Christine. I can't remember Christine. And for some reason, she just took a bet on me. And thank God, I didn't disappoint. I did the show notes for her. And that's how I first got introduced into podcasts. So I worked with her for a while, I think for close to a month or so. Then after that, I decided that I'd grown enough wings to fly solo. So I started working with my own clients. So it's been a journey since 2019 to date. I've worked with countless podcasts, and I look forward to working with even more. And that's been my journey.
Wow, that's awesome. You've mentioned about show notes. Someone listening to this podcast, maybe the person doesn't know what is that new podcast manager, someone that is aspiring to be a podcast manager and is hearing about that term for the first time.
Right, sure. So show notes are a summary of the podcast, whereby you take the time to listen to the podcast, you pick up the juicy details of the podcast and put it in words. We're used to having transcripts, but not this, a summarized written version of the podcast. So it varies from client to client, podcast host to podcast host. So you'll find some that are so detailed, while others you just need to highlight, just give a hook to get people to listen to the podcast, include the timestamps. Then you get some gems from the podcast, which you can call them magical quotes. And if there's any information shared in the episode, maybe a book, a website, you just add it to your show notes, just to make sure people can get a glimpse of the episode without having to listen to the whole episode.
Okay. Wow. That's a good explanation. I know even if you haven't done podcast management before, that one summarizes everything. So what motivated you to be a virtual assistant and what you're doing currently remotely?
Well, I think virtual assistant is something you grow into, because I got into the freelancing world, I think, in around 2017. So as usual, we all start with article writing and we grow into other things. Yes, and I think by around 2018, there was a whole buzzword like virtual assistants, and by default, you just go for this shiny thing that's shining all over. And that's why I got into it. And I've worked with a couple of people doing different tasks. Some will be handling their social media, others you're going to be scheduling content for them, like on WordPress. Others you're going to be doing their podcast. So it's a whole range of things that I've done with as a virtual assistant, and I believe it's something enjoyable and I love it.
So I know about podcasting. I'm also a podcast manager. I know it involves a lot of things to do, including pre-production, searching for the guests, post-production, you do the editing, you do the marketing on social media and so on. And how do you assist your podcast hosts, the people that, the clients that you handle, how do you assist them in all these stages?
All right. So with the pre-production, as you mentioned, you start with, sometimes you have to book the guests for them. So you research on the most suitable guests for them and get in touch with them and book them for a recording. So once you have your guests, you need to now go research on what would you like to talk about with the guest. Actually, just getting the questions such that you do not want to like have a template that you use on everyone. So sometimes you need to get like a few questions that are just specific to the guest. So you get those. And for some clients, they prefer having a script. So I'll write a script for them and that will guide them through the episode. When it comes to recording, mostly the client just does, I'll prepare the links and everything. Then the client will do the recording and send the recorded version to me. So it could be a video or an audio, depending on what the client wants. So I do the editing. Once I do the editing, I pull the gems out of it, like the making audiograms, getting some snippets that will be essential for marketing. And that's also where we do the show notes and create posts for social media and also emails for their email marketing.
That's so detailed. I know some of it. Yeah. I know it's a lot of work, especially with podcasts management, where you have to search for guests. And sometimes you reach out to people and they're like, oh, no, I'm not ready to be hosted. Have you had a situation where you're searching for guests for your clients and you reach out to someone and that person says, you have to pay me to appear on the show?
Yes, especially this, I would say, quote unquote, big people, because they feel like, time is money and time is a currency. So they do not want to freely give their time, especially if you're not a big podcast, because at the end of the day, they look at it and feel like there's nothing in it for them. So it happens and it's continuing to happen. And as things change, I feel like you'll get to a point whereby you'll have to pay people to be your guests.
Yeah, talking about that, I was reaching out to someone, and then when I went to his website, he mentioned specifically that I'll only appear on your podcast if I see there is something I'm going to get. So it's not like I'm going to give you audience and you don't give me something. So yes. I already got scared. I didn't even go far.
Yeah, but it is natural because, you know, like taking the time to appear on a podcast, you're already using up some time. And sometimes if there's nothing in it for you, you'll feel like, and you're not feeling philanthropic at that point, you'll feel like you cheated. But it is the world we live in.
Yeah, I know it's normal, especially for someone who has walked up the ladder and has created something big for himself. So sometimes they feel like, okay, I don't want to waste my time. Yeah, so when I read that on the website, I kept off.
But you never know, sometimes you can reach out to these people and maybe that day they're feeling philanthropic enough to share their time with you.
Yeah, I think I should try some time in the future.
Yeah, you should.
When I'm confident enough, because I just figured out and feel like it's going to respond whichever way it feels like that day.
You know, the one thing I love a lot about life is it can either be a yes or a no, and what's the worst anyway? There's nothing worse than a no.
Worse than a no.
There's nothing worse than a no.
If there's something to fear, it's fear itself. So there's nothing much to fear if you've not feared fear.
Yeah, You know, sometimes you just have to let yourself feel the fear. And anyway, just send the email and wait for the worst. If the worst is coming, maybe you never get the worst, you'll get the best.
Do you usually do the same tasks for all clients or different clients with different requests?
Different clients have different requests. So you'll find that one person wants you to just do the post-production. Others want to get you involved during the pre-production. So it varies. And also in the post-production, you'll find some people just want you to do the show notes, upload the audio and post to the social media platforms. While others will want you to edit the episode, upload to the content management systems, that is either Buzzsprout, Spotify, whatever platform they're using, and do the show notes. So it varies from client to client.
Okay. Yeah. I also have some that they usually do the live and then they want you to take the live, yes. Extract the audio and upload, and that's all.
Yes. What's been your experience working with podcasters? Are you having as much fun as I am?
Yeah. Initially, I didn't like it because I felt like not everyone is engaging. Someone doesn't follow a solo podcast. You listen to it. It's so boring. You're like, okay. And it's 1 hour long. You have to edit something. It's 1 hour long. And it's so boring. Initially, I didn't like it, but as time went by, I realized someone can be boring, but it can be giving in some useful information. So you get used to it, you learn to listen, to keep up with the boring nature of your client, to keep up with those ones that when they speak, you feel like you want to listen to that full hour, and then you forget about the editing part. So, yeah. You have fun and sometimes you don't have that fun. So
I'll say that again.
Yeah, speaking about that, what are some of the common challenges you're facing as a podcast manager?
Well, I think the first one would be, as you pointed out, sometimes you have a client who's doing an episode and you're like, Lord, who's even supposed to listen to this? You know, because... Yeah, some are quite like, you know, like there is a way you can record a podcast and there is flow. Some clients will just record and the flow is not there. The consistent, you don't know how you got from that digression is like 100%. Like you're talking about one thing, then quickly digressing to something else without notice, and sometimes it's hard to keep up. So I think that's one of the things. The other thing would be lack of consistency with the podcast. So someone records today and then they'll record again after another month. So I don't know with that how they're supposed to ever gain traction.
I think it depends. There are some that do it monthly, just one episode a month, others weekly, others bi-weekly. So I think it depends.
You know, like when you start talking to someone, they'll tell you like, I want to be doing an episode weekly. Then along the way, they fall off the wagon. Plus also the podcasting world, for you to get the numbers, you need to be very consistent. And with the one episode per month, it's quite tricky to get the traction. So
yeah, so
that's one thing I find a challenge, because sometimes you've carved out time for someone and they're not really showing up for you. Also, you find sometimes you have like poorly recorded episodes such that there's a lot of noise, there's a lot going on, and you can hardly know what to cut out and what not to cut out, because what you have is basically poor quality.
Yeah, it happens a lot. It happens a lot. You realize someone went recorded, and during the recording, maybe the internet was like the one that is disturbing us and there was some lagging and so on. And then it wants you to edit the video and make sure that there is some kind of synchronization between the audio and the video. So it gives you a hard time, but you have to do it. But then at some point, because you can't do it and it needs to be perfect, you just say, no, this can't work.
Sure, I've done that.
Yeah, the fight.
part of parenting.
Yeah, those are some of the challenges. And there was something that I wanted to mention, but my postpartum is overworking. I've already forgotten. Do you think things like this?
Sorry?
Do you have this forgetfulness, the one that I'm having right now?
I don't remember it being that high. I don't remember it being that much. Yours is on a higher level.
Mine is on a higher level. If you tell me something right now and I don't do it, forget about it. I'll remember that one later.
Yeah, and that is where just writing down everything you need to do just comes in handy.
Yeah, like now, as we were talking about the challenges that we face, especially when working with people, I had something in my mind. Then the next second, it's not there.
It's okay. I'm sure it will come as we go along.
It's too early.
It's too early.
Yeah. Okay. So... I think you covered something that I wanted to ask. So in your journey as a virtual assistant and a podcast manager, what's that aha moment, that point where you said, okay, I'm now okay, this is my aha moment, something that turned everything, changed everything, your turning point?
Wow. It's a difficult one. I think I would say, being a Kenyan, being in the industry as a Kenyan, I always heard stories of people saying that you can have a lifestyle funded by freelancing. Either it was a serious joke, because regardless of what I did, I never saw that happening in my life. Then at some point it happened, and I was like, oh my God, seems I'm on the right track. And then I moved to podcasting, and that was like, did I just find home for myself? Like, I am now addicted to podcasts. So I felt like once I came to a point where it was sustaining, and then I found podcasting, and it felt like I'd found that thing that I've been looking for online. So I don't know that that's supposed to be an aha moment for me. I don't know.
Yeah, it is, because that's the moment you realize, okay, actually this thing works.
Yeah.
Because not everyone feels like, not everyone thinks the same until they have that turning point where they see things are working practically. I think it happens for all of us. And some, they usually describe their turning point as the time they made their highest money, their highest earning. That is where they say, this was my turning point. That was my aha moment. Yeah. What else should I ask you? What are some of the some of the tools that any podcast manager should learn?
Five tools. I think that will be vast, because if you want to break it down to editing tools, okay, for editing tools, I think Audacity works for me. I think it's something that you should learn. The script is something you must know. Canva is a must-have in your toolkit. Then you need Headliner for your audiograms. You need to have you need to understand Riverside for the recordings. And then you'll need to have an email marketing tool. And then, you have a Weebly, you have MailChimp, you have so many. I don't know which one would choose, but I think lately I'm falling in love with a Weebly. And what else would you? Well, there's a tool I just discovered. It's called Cast Magic. Oh my God, that is.
Mention Capture.
Sorry?
I thought you were going to mention Capture. for iTunes where you upload your audio, it does the transcript.
Yes.
You can create blog posts from it. You can create your audiograms. Yeah.
Yeah, Castmagic does equally the same thing, and I think it's something I'm falling in love too fast with too fast because you'll upload it and then it will give you some juicy details of the podcast, such as the transcripts. It will give you ideas on what you might want to call the podcast, like the title. Then it also gives you like the timestamps, though I must say they're never accurate. It also gives you some social media ideas on some things that you don't post on your socials. And if you're into reels, it gives you some real ideas that you're going to about the episode. So it's something I'm falling in love with, but it doesn't do the audiograms. So for audiograms, I'm still with Headliner.
I'm hearing about Castmagic for the first time. I think I'm going to check it out.
Please do.
I also creating my audiograms using a Buzzsprout. They have that in the
picture. Yes,
there is the Wave. There is another tool I found online. I can't remember the name. So I think there's so many. So for someone that is getting into this niche, they need to learn a lot. They have a
lot. But I think Canva is the easiest to use for audiograms.
Yeah. Canva is also great. They are adding so many features, including the AI feature, where you can change your images the way you want.
Yes.
Wow. Your last words, your final words, not last, your final words.
Before we get to my final words, I think I have some questions for you.
Yeah.
So I know you've been in the industry for a long minute, and I'm sure over time you've gained a lot of knowledge, wisdom, name it. And maybe there's one of your listeners out there who's like, wait, these people are talking about an aha moment and they're talking about money. Where do you get these clients that pay you this this money that you're talking about? So,
okay, for clients, right?
Mm-hmm.
For clients, I think someone first needs to niche down. You must identify that area that you're perfect in. There are always five things that you can do right without making a mistake. Or even if you're going to make a mistake, it's just a few tiny mistakes. So you need to identify those areas that you feel, okay, even if you assign me work at night, I can handle this without any problems. Niche down. Yes. And then search for your clients aggressively. Don't even rest. When you go online, go to social media, because before you find that specific place that works for you, you've done a lot of work. It's not going to come easy that you just went to Facebook, you find a client, and that's all. No. I advise people to explore all the areas. Facebook, Upwork, Fiverr, people per hour. For me, I tried cold pitching back like 2 years ago, and it really worked for me. I've never done it again. I've also had some good clients from referrals. That means you do a good work and you make sure you make noise a lot so that people identify you. Like they see podcasting, they identify it with fear. They see social media, they identified with you because they have seen your work and they have heard about you. I always say that you don't have to post on your page, but make sure in the groups you are in, you're engaging. People are posting about jobs where they're asking. People are asking questions that they're responding. And always know where your clients hang out. If you're looking for podcast clients, go to podcasting groups. That is where your clients hang out. If you're looking to create sales pages, landing pages for your clients, go to software like ClickFunnels, System, Katavi, Katra, those groups, hang in there. That is where your clients post jobs. And if you're going to reach out through cold pitching, make sure you understand your clients. Go to their website, see what they do. Like, go to websites like matchmaker.fm. Maybe you are looking for clients in the health niche. That is where you want to do the podcast management. Go to places like Matchmake FM, search people that are podcasting in your niche, then start reaching out to them. But make sure you don't copy the flying templates. There are these templates flying around that everyone has. So get the templates, but make sure you customize them to match your needs, the needs of your clients. Example, if I give you a template, I use this to reach out to different clients. My clients' needs are not your clients' needs, or the way I looked at my clients may not look at them the same way. So when you go to those websites, sometimes use the words they use. I went to a website and I realized the client said he has a passion for doing whatever that he was doing. And I used that one on them. So every time I reach out, I want to make sure that I tell you, I can see the passion you have helping your client. Yeah, so you make them feel okay. You have at least done your research and you know about them. You know what they do and you appreciate.
Yes. Yeah. You know what I'm loving about this whole thing is that, you know, the online world has been painted to be a get rich overnight thing. But from what you said, it's good that people will know, like, you'll have to sit and work. It's not something that's being presented to you on a silver platter.
Yeah, you're not going to get those high-paying clients overnight unless you get someone like me. Maybe I know you and I give you work. That means you're not going to search for clients. But for you to land where you are, you have to do a lot of work searching, getting rejections, getting those clients saying, okay, I don't hire Africans. Someone canceling a meeting with you when you are waiting on Zoom. Those things happen. And it actually happened to me. I had a client, we agreed on everything. I'm on Zoom waiting for the client. And then I get a cancellation email like, no reason. I'm like, okay, maybe she realized I'm not from the race. I'm an African. And some, they could tell you openly. When you reach out, they tell you, I don't work with people from your country. Yeah, before you get to that level where you say, okay, I've made money, you have to suffer those consequences of an African.
I think we should put that on a t-shirt, like, it's not an overnight success. It's not proven success. It's work.
Yeah, it's work, because there is a way that the Kenyan content creators are painting the online, like the online platforms, TikTok, Facebook, Instagram. You know, the way they make money, they make it look like the moment you get into TikTok, you have money. They are not telling people that before you get that fame and money, you've done a lot of work in the background and you're still doing a lot of work in the background without people knowing what you do. They only see the video that you post. Thank you so much for showing up. I know we have been postponing this for quite some time, and I thank God the rains today decided to show us some grapes. So thank you so much for sharing your journey with us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been an awesome moment, and
thank you.